Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. And I will mainly talk on drug-eluting balloons because there is not that much evidence of the use of drug-eluting stents in dialysis access occlusions or stenosis. We all know that renal failure is a big problem. End-stage renal disease is very prevalent both in the US and in Europe. And on the right-hand side of the slide, you can see the path from end-stage renal disease to AV access failure. Of course, not all the patients get into a AV access. Most of them, or a lot of them, are also treated by peritoneal dialysis, renal transplant, but still we have a lot of procedures being done for renal failure, and this amounts up to a cost of $90,000 per year per patient. The pathogenesis is the vascular trauma occurring during the access creation, then the occurrence of hemodynamic shear stress trauma leading to fibrotic lesion formation, an inflammatory reaction secondary to any intervention that occurs afterwards, like surgical corrections or endovascular procedures, and then last but not least, the chronic renal failure induces massive endothelial dysfunction because of the uremia, oxidative stress, and inflammation. Here you can see all the factors listed again, and on the right-hand side, one of the other factors that's very important is that there are histological differences between veins and arteries that produce incongruent wall stretching and intimal proliferation. The lesions are not like arterial lesions. They are typically located in the access vein in 60%, at the level of the anastomosis in 20%, another 20% in the central vein, and arterial inflow problems are very rare. Most of the time, it's a single stenosis. In 40% of cases, also multiple stenosis, and typically the lesions are focal with a large tendency to elastic recoil. Then we have one-third of cases that are de novo stenosis, then a third a first restenosis, and then another third of patients come back with a recurrent restenosis. Often these lesions are very resistant to POBA. You need high-pressure balloons or long balloon inflations or cutting balloons to achieve a normal diameter in up to 35 to 40% of cases. But this use of high-pressure balloons or cutting balloons will not lead to better long-term patency. And that means that less than 50% of patients treated still have a patent fistula after balloon angioplasty. Here again, a list of all the treatment options: POBA, cutting balloon angioplasty, high-pressure balloon angioplasty, and more recently also scoring balloon angioplasty that I tend to use much more. Stenting actually does not have a place in peripheral lesions, actually only in central stenosis, and covered stents have only a role in the treatment of stenosis at the end of an AV graft and not an AV native fistula. The typical way I perform the procedure is on an outpatient basis. You don't need any immobilization afterwards. Inflow and outflow should be visualized, and then you are faced with a problem that you need to get the flow countercurrent. That can be done by using external compression by a tourniquet or with manual compression, but take care that you don't put your hands inside of the X-ray beam. You can also use balloon occlusion or try to advance the catheter into the arterial side. Direct puncture, typically when there is still space, a cuff around the upper arm, and then inflow, anastomosis, and outflow visualization. Here you can see an image on the left-hand side with the cuff deflated. No arterial inflow is seen, but when you inflate the cuff, you can see the backflow of the contrast into the arterial side, and then when you release the cuff, you can also get an idea of the outflow. An alternative method is to perform an internal occlusion. This is a stenosis in the upper arm that doesn't allow actually to put a cuff around the upper arm. And then by inflating the balloon inside the stenosis and while doing so and while treating the patient and injecting through the introduction sheath, you can get visualization of the arterial side. Here an example of a typical focal stenosis treated in, at first with a scoring balloon that you can see enter here. There's nothing very special about it, but I think with the focal stress specifically for these very tight and diaphragmatic lesions, this is a good option. And then afterwards you follow-up with a drug-eluting balloon, as you can see here. And this is the balloon in place, and then this is the final angiographic outcome. And you can see that there is a very smooth transition now to the wider part of the vein. What about the results of DCB versus POBA? There are several studies, and the first came out in 2014. And here you can see that there is a benefit of drug-coated balloons as compared to POBA. And the second study that came out in 2015 showed also a benefit with regards to TLR freedom and also circuit primary patency. And here you can see again from the same group in another publication, benefit of paclitaxel-coated balloons versus plain balloon angioplasty. This was specifically so in the occurrence of angiographic restenosis, significantly lower, and also the repeat angioplasty procedures. And as you can see from this table, circuit thrombosis was not really different, but I think the gain from using drug-coated balloons is mainly in reducing the repeat angioplasty procedures, and this was also addressed by this group. 40 patients randomized, so still a relatively small group, but because of the reduction of the number of interventions afterwards, it was shown to be a very cost-effective treatment. Also in central vein stenosis with a coated balloon, you can get the same good results. This was a study where they used also a crossover design, and actually the coated balloons did much better than the bare balloons. This is the table that lists all the randomized data, and you can see that in all the studies at 6 and 12 months, there were better results using DCB as compared to POBA. Also for the several single-arm studies that are available and retrospective analysis, you can see that there is a benefit in all cases with the use of drug-coated balloons, sometimes even, as you can see here, in the third column, combined with cutting balloons. This is not randomized data, however. Last year, there was a systematic review, published six studies, 254 interventions. The number of interventions is still relatively low, two randomized controlled trials at a time and four cohort studies. There was device failure, that means wasting of the angioplasty balloon, in two studies with an incidence of 55 and 92.8%. And I think this is an important thing to keep in mind, and the reason why I tend to use more scoring balloons nowadays than in the past, because the typical low-pressure balloon will not be able to open up the artery enough. The six-month primary patency was in the range of 70 to 97% for the drug-coated balloons, and a very meager 0 to 26% for POBA in this systematic review. Also looking at a meta-analysis, again from the same group from Greece, from Kitru, you can see that as compared to other techniques, cutting balloons and covered stents, there's much more benefit. The forest plot here shows the diamond much more towards the right-hand side, indicating a greater benefit of paclitaxel-coated balloons as compared to covered stent or cutting balloon treatment. So to conclude, there is a growing body of evidence of clinical efficacy and cost-effectiveness of DEB in AV fistula, but as in peripheral DCB use, there is a need for vessel preparation and also a need for a long inflation time. Thank you very much.